Yeah, thank you. I'd like to thank the organizers for giving me the opportunity to make this presentation. I have one question. I saw a couple of people who were also at the summer school last fall in Hersching. Who was in Hersching? Okay, that's still not the majority. Because there's some overlap, but also for the Hersching people, there will be new material here. Good, so this is a comes in three installments. First today, with the general introduction to proof mining, or as Kreisel has totally called it, the program of unwinding proofs. And then we will tomorrow develop the main proof theoretic techniques to do so, and also what I call logical meter theory. So sometimes the Kreisel program has been criticized, for example, by Pfefferman as being ad hoc. So you take a proof, sometimes you're lucky, you extract a new result, then you call this an application of logic. If you're not lucky, then you try another proof. But here this approach is actually substantiated by general logical results, which are called meter theorems, which explain why a certain result is possible. Not, of course, the concrete nature of the bound, that is the polynomial exponential bound, of course, for that one has to actually carry out the extraction, but that there must be a bound of a certain type hidden in the proof. So I call this logical meter theorems, which then also can be used, and they have been actually quite recently, to systematically find new results, even in mathematics, knowing that something must be possible. And then finally, this will be the climax and third lecture, which is unfortunately on Saturday at 8:30, but it's the most important part of this thing, the actual applications. But so since maybe not everybody will be here on Saturday 8:30, I mentioned already in one application in this talk, so as a kind of taste of what you will see in massive style on Saturday. Good. So proof mining, is the idea of using systematically proof theoretic transformations with the goal to extract new information from proofs. This is mostly concerns quantitative information like bounds, or in particular in analysis, rates of convergence for iterative procedures and so on, but also qualitative results, namely to show that, for example, the rate of convergence is independent from certain parameters, or it's actually a uniform convergence. And so I started to develop this many years ago, and the most applications there were in nonlinear fixed point theory, but meanwhile, a lot of results in ergodic theory have been obtained, and the current concentration of work is in continuous convex optimization, but also topological dynamics, approximation theory, this was actually very early in the 90s, and Cauchy problems, and nonlinear silly groups, and so on. And by application, that means you really get a result which one, in the end, is of interest to core mathematicians, so these results are typically published in specialized journals of the respective area of mathematics. In doing so, of course, one has to cut short a little bit on the logical syntax, so you cannot introduce Gödel's T in or dependent types or whatever in this context. But the analysts are sufficiently open to allow for a couple of pages, a section to explain what is going on in logical terms. Of course, you have to avoid to introduce formal systems and so on, but it's possible. So you don't have to completely hide how this has been achieved. And then I said there are these logical meter theorems. I started with this in 2005, and then with Philip Gerard we extended this, and most recently with Günzel, and there are other frameworks, other type of interpretations suitable for other applications. Henry Tausner, Jeremy Abigat, Fernando Ferreira, and so on have also developed formal frameworks for doing stuff of this kind. And then there's an interesting discussion and a connection between a proposal Terence Tao had formulated in 2008, where he called for a kind of finitary version of doing analysis, and there are some striking parallels to the proof theoretic techniques used here. So as a source, you can, until 2008, the comprehensive treatment of the underlying methodology, and some applications are in this book for results. Since 2008, I recommend this paper here, the recent large survey paper, which is available online on my homepage. It's actually anyhow available online because it's an open access journal. And then a general survey on the whole thing for people who are very busy, have little time, so this is just 21 pages for the whole thing. This is another survey I wrote recently, and it's also on my homepage. So since we had a lot of comments already on history, also this enterprise starts by connecting it to history and the roots of proof theory. As you all know, Hilbert's program concerned the issue of solving, of justifying the use of ideal set theoretic principles in mathematics by showing once and for all that they are consistent, and if you show that they are consistent in some finitistic framework, then it is often overlooked. It actually follows that in the same finitistic fragment you can prove every purely universal statement which could have been proven with the ideal elements. And if you call, as Hilbert did, a purely universal statement about natural numbers like Fermat's last theorem or Goldbach conjecture, whatever, you call this a real statement, then you can say, well, you can freely use whatever you want, except the methods in proving this. If then somebody comes and questions the legitimacy of this use, you can just refer him to this result. That is a routine procedure of rewriting in a messy way this proof and a proof in finitistic mathematics in the same statement. That would have been the consequence of Hilbert's program to recover, not just about consistency, but about arbitrary and universal statements. Jo. Now you know Gödel's incompleteness theorem shows that this is not possible. Some people like to call this the collapse of Hilbert's program, which I think is completely wrong, as we will see. And I think this is also a foundational consequence of this proof mining enterprise. We will see to what amazing extent Hilbert was actually correct. First of all, every proof in mathematics of some concrete statement contains concrete finitistic information about that concrete statement. Point one. Point two, even if one takes, which one might think is a too narrow view, to identify finitary combinatorial content by formalizable and primitive recursive arithmetic, even if that is taken, it is true up to 99% of mathematics. You know, in all of the about hundreds or whatever bounds people have extracted, there's only one case where currently the bound is not primitive recursive. Most it's an issue of being a polynomial, a simple exponential function, or things like that. And this happens even in the proof of Zorn's lemma and whatnot. So to a large extent, Hilbert was correct that ordinary mathematics, core mathematics, can be reduced, actually also the consistency of it, to primitive recursive arithmetic. You know, this has been also investigated in the context of reverse mathematics, where people showed that you can make very, very strong, mathematically strong, conservative extensions of primitive recursive arithmetic, which allow to carry out most of mathematics. And if you cannot, like principles of sequential compactness, you almost ever can replace them by other principles in the proof. So that Gödel phenomena are extremely rare in core mathematics. And there is, of course, this program, this exciting program by Harvey Friedman to find instances of Gödel's phenomenon in mainstream mathematics, but this is very difficult, and the examples are famous because it's so difficult to find one, and Harvey Friedman is the world champion in finding such, but this already indicates, if you get famous by finding such an instance, how rare this actually is. And that asks for an explanation, which I'm not able to give. It's just an empirical fact that Hilbert basically always was correct. Now, nevertheless, the full program wasn't possible, so what Hilbert and his school and people later pursuing Hilbert's program focused on the relative consistency. Well, first of all, to calibrate the contribution of ideal principles in proofs. Well, if that contribution is not just primitive recursive, then you calibrate what it is. But also to give relative consistency proofs. And again, we mentioned this already this morning, basically in every work Gödel did, he was directly influenced by Hilbert. So when Gödel wrote Gödel's T, he took it from Hilbert on infinity. When Gödel wrote V equals L, he took the inspiration from Gödel on infinity. When Gödel solved the completeness problem, he took the inspiration from the first formulation of the completeness problem in Hilbert Ackermann. And he also took, of course, inspiration from Hilbert's program to give the first relative consistency proofs. One famous one he proved in 33 was to show that if intuitionistic, let's say number theory would be inconsistent, then so would be classical number theory, because there's a negative translation of classical arithmetic into intuitionistic one. That is a complete triviality, so it's as finitistic as it gets. And so intuitionistic arithmetic is not more secure than the classical one. A more famous example is Gödel showed that adding the axiom of choice doesn't create any inconsistencies, because if in ZFZ you could prove 0 equals 1, then you could already prove it in ZF. And therefore, the axiom of choice is completely irrelevant when it comes to issues of consistency strength. In contrast to the comprehension, which already Hermann Weyl realized that this is a real point, but not the axiom of choice. So these were striking successes in connection with relative consistency proof, and this Gödel paper on the axiom of choice basically resolved the issue. After Gödel, nobody actually questioned the consistency of the axiom of choice anymore. So it was to the satisfaction of core mathematicians solved this problem. Good, and so this is what I said. Hilbert is largely vindicated, so no collapse. He is a great Hilbert, and so we'll see. Now, what the people after Hilbert did is to indeed focus on consistency proofs and to state proof theoretic results exclusively in terms of consistency proofs. Gödel, who developed the main technique in 41, the so-called functional interpretation, which is used in this very applied Hilbertian enterprise of proof mining, he never published it in 41. When he finally published it in 58, he removed all traces for possible applications to mathematics, which he had in his original publication, and just sold this as a consistency proof of PPR mathematics. Now, when you talk about such things, as Kreisel pointed out, it is always a kind of fishy thing. You know, what do you mean by proving the consistency of elementary number theory? When first of all, is elementary number theory in need of a consistency proof? And even if you convince some mathematician that it might be so, then why should the particular use of transfinite induction or whatever you use to show the consistency of be more secure than the original thing? So here, this already by St. Thomas Aquinas faced already the same issue in this very nice phrase here, which I used when I gave a talk on this topic in Toulouse, where the tomb of Thomas Aquinas is. And this was basically what Kreisel considered. There are these obviously very valuable deep results of Gensen, the analysis of Peranormatik, of Gödel, again investigated the Peranormatik, but they are sort of insufficiently presented as proofs of consistency, because if you say these people prove the consistency of Peranormatik, then such a statement is immediately subject to these criticisms, if not laughter, which actually happened to Gensen's proofs, a famous mathematician. So Gensen was a person who proved the consistency of number theory by using transfinite induction, and so on. Of course, nonsense. But what Kreisel pointed out, that one should say in more proper words what has been achieved in these proof theoretic works. And so one of his slogans was to answer rather this question: what more do we know if we have proved a theorem by restricted means both Gödel in his consistency proof and Gensen gave a clear answer to this, because what they actually did is, in particular, to characterize the class of programs whose totality you can show per harmonic. Gensen said these are the alpha less than epsilon not recursive functions. Gödel said these are the ones in Gödel's T-definable one, and in particular these two coincide, obviously, because of that, because they both characterized. So if you take this Gödel T formulation, you can write on a beer bagel, you know, this thing where you have a beer glass in your last one. On this size, you can write a programming language, and you say the functions definable in this programming language are precisely the ones per harmonic understands. I mean, this is a clear kind of result. Nobody can say it's pointless or philosophically dubious or whatever. So this is one thing. But it was only Kreisel who actually stated this explicitly. You know, only Kreisel defined what alpha less than epsilon not recursive functions are and said that's actually what Gensen proved. Yeah, here's Kreisel when he gave a lecture at his 85th birthday in my place in Darmstadt. And the lecture is somewhere available. I sent it to Bartz at the event. It's a DVD, so it's possible to watch this. Good. Now, what is proof mining in general? It is about analyzing proofs. So the input is you have a proof, P, of some conclusion, C. And although I said there are also qualitative issues of uniformity and so on which matter, historically, but also still until today, the main direction of research has been to extract computational content bounds from proofs which are prima facie non-effective. And so the additional information you might want to get effective bounds, algorithms, yeah, the type of dependence of from parameters, is that continuous or maybe full independence, but also generalizations of proofs. It often happens once you replace all the ideal machinery, let's say abstract functional and analytic principles from proof, then what you have actually used, you see, it doesn't just hold in Hilbert space, it holds in much larger class of structures, for example, in certain geometric situations, so-called zero spaces, which is a hot topic in mathematics, to generalize results from a linear setting to a geodesic setting. And you know, you don't have any of these principles available. There's no Hahn-Banach or so, because you don't have any linearity in this. But if you haven't used it any longer because you've eliminated it, then it might be that you can immediately see that what you have used also holds in a more general context. So, to start completely here, basic, suppose you have a statement of the form for every natural number x, there is a natural number y, such that some specification is to be met, and one might ask to get a bound or witness for this. And you will see that already in this easy form there are substantial limitations and problems. But before we discuss these substantial limitations and problems, I will give you at least one taster of a real result which comes out of this. So if you are not in shape on Saturday at 8:30. So here's a recent result which I like very much as an advertising result, because it's extremely the statement is extremely natural. Every high school mathematician can understand. And it's classical, has been studied since von Neumann. The proof is extremely non-effective in principle, in at least prima facie, these sans lemma and whatever. But the result you prove is completely concrete. And if you apply proof mining to it, you get a polynomial bound. So it's the best thing you can have. So what is the situation? It's a so-called alternating projection problem. So you have a Hilbert space. I mean, if you talk to high school students, you can just say Rn. Otherwise, you say Hilbert space. And you have finitely many convex subsets, no assumption. And you take the projection onto them, which in Hilbert space is a single valued, well-defined map. And then you project first to the first, to the second, and to the nth. And this whole package you call T. And then you keep iterating T. And you know the classical result, which was already form that was already stated by von Neumann was supposed. You have just two sets, and you do this, and you start projecting, say, to here, and then you project to here, and then you project to here, and then you project to here, and so on. And eventually, what you converge to is points where the minimal distance is attained. This is actually false in infinite dimensional spaces. You have only weak convergence, which was only proven in the 2000s. I mean, it's quite amazing. But in Rn, certainly this holds. But except for the case n equals 2 and other situations, special cases, the general problem whether you actually, as I said, the strong convergence is false even in these cases if you have an infinite dimensional space, but at least what you should have is if you iterate one more time, then the distance between having been here and having been here should become smaller and smaller. So the displacement should become smaller and smaller between these points. And this is the so-called minimal displacement conjecture. So you could also say, after n many iterations, this point has become an epsilon fixed point for the iterator t. If you apply it one more time t, then the distance you get from this to this is smaller than epsilon. And that is and that works for every epsilon. From one moment on, this will always be the case, and so this tends to zero. Now the proof, as I mentioned, uses a whole arsenal of complicated tools, but it will become clear by the third lecture why it is immediate that using proof theory you can do something and even get a full rate of convergence here. And the rate of convergence I recently extracted. And first of all, it's a polynomial in all the data. And secondly, you see there are very few data around anyhow. So there's only the error epsilon, I mean this epsilon here. There is the total number of convex sets. This is the capital N. There is some initial displacement. So you start from a starting point and you ask yourself how much is the initial displacement. And then, well, these sets here have to be non-empty, otherwise you cannot project. And the only other data you use is you just pick any points in your sets, lowercase c1 to cn, and any norm upper bound of them, k, is fine. So you just need a norm upper bound on some points in your set. This is k. And then you have this result. So the bound is in particular the same in every Hilbert space for every convex set, and so on. And it's very concrete, I hope you agree. If you unwind what this means, it's a polynomial of degree 8 in epsilon. Good. So now back to the simple situation. So a naive attempt would be to try, whenever you see a for all exist statement, say here about natural numbers, to try, starting from the axioms throughout the rules and the proof, to imitate this proof with effective information. Unfortunately, this is impossible because already when this F is purely universal, there are counterexamples to this in the most strong sense. There are statements of this form, for all exist, followed by a universal statement, where A is logically valid. Logically, I guess I should be valid. So there's not an issue about what type of mathematics you use. I mean, you use zero mathematics, it's just logically valid. And yet, irrespective of what complexity you ask for, there isn't even a recursive, not even a computable bound on Y. And of course, the people here in constructive mathematics, they of course know why that is, because the law of excluded minima is, when I say logically valid, of course I mean in the normal sense of logic. And here is the counterexample, so one takes these Clini, the elementary primitive recursive, or you can make it even polytimer, wherever you like, but it's a primitive recursive Clini T predicate, which expresses the property txyz holds if the Turing machine with code x applied to the number y has a terminating run which is coded by z. and the special halting problem to ask whether the Turing machine with code X applied to X stops is therefore the problem, is there a Y for which T X X Y holds? Now you take this statement, if you shuffle the quantifiers back inside, you see this is just the log split middle. It just says the Turing machine either stops or does not stop. Then you pull out the quantifiers in this order and you get a statement of the form above. And suppose now you would have a computable bound, let alone a witness, but just a bound on Y, then you could of course solve this to use this to decide the halting problem. Because how would you now decide whether there is a Y with TXXY, where you just check all the Ys up to GX, whether one of those does it, and if none of those does, well then there isn't one. So, therefore there cannot be a computable solution. So, the problem is, if you prove a for all exist statement and this is quantifier free and hence decidable, there is of course always a computable solution by searching for the least, which is not possible here. But of course we want to get information like a polynomial bound or so, which reflects the computational content of a given proof. But if the proof uses a lemma of this form, you cannot just say, okay, then I spend an afternoon trying to find the computational witness for this lemma, and once I have that, I move on and towards my conclusion. Because a lemma doesn't have a computational interpretation, at least not in the naive form. So we see already when it comes to statements of for all exist for all, we have to reformulate what we mean by computational content in a more sophisticated way. It's too crude just to say everything is just witnessed effectively. Good. By the way, you don't have the problem here. That's the first observation you do, because it's a trivial fact that this convergence decreases to zero. And because it decreases to zero, the convergence actually for all exists and not for all exists for all. But of course, internally, the proof uses statements much more complicated than the one we even saw. But the conclusion is extremely nice in the logical form. Good. Good. So what about weakening, therefore, the requirement? So logically, in some sense, equivalent to A is its so-called Hellbrown normal form. Some people call it Skolem normal form, but it's actually the Skolem normal form of negation, negated. And I call this Hellbrown normal form. So for those who know the Skolem normal form, it's just the dual. So here we weaken the statement by replacing universal quantifiers by function symbols depending on the existential quantifiers in front. Clearly, A implies AH, but conversely, the provability of AH implies the provability of A, or the validity of AH implies the validity of A. So the Hellbrown normal form is a so-called validity normal form. And if you use a second order device, so the axiom of choice, on the second order level, then you can actually prove that they are equivalent. So, mathematically, they are clearly equivalent. Yeah? Because suppose, in one direction from here to here is trivial, how to prove from here to here? Suppose this is true, and suppose this would be false, then for every x1 there is a y1, such that for every x2 there's a y2. Let's call this y1 f of x1, and let's call the y2 g of x1, g2. Then with these functions f and g, you get a contradiction to this. The argument is precisely the same as you remember from your first semester calculus course, when you proved that a function from R to R, if it's sequential continuous at x, this is the same as being epsilon delta continuous, exactly the same. So here is again. So in some sense, you still talk about the same statement. Now, what is the benefit? If you now think about this in terms of higher order systems where you can quantify over the for all f, for all g, then this is again a for all exist statement which should be nice. Before it was, for example, for all exist for all, or in this case already exist for all, exist for all. So certainly we have already all the problems because of this pattern here. But now it's exist respectively for all exist. So this should be easier to handle. And we know this particular simple case where this has been handled in a very beautiful way is the case of just plain pure logic. It's particularly nice if it's logic without equality. Then Herpon settled what you do. So you take such a statement, you don't try to find a weakness for y, but what you do is you first do this Herpon normal form. So here's again this statement which caused the trouble here, this one. Now I just write a generic predicate P instead of TXX. Okay? So you do the Herpon normal form, and now you can form an easy Herpon disjunction, because if A is logically valid, so this is logically valid. And by Herpon's theorem, if a purely existential statement is logically valid, then there are finitely many terms built up out of the material of the formula, maybe with some constant, if there wasn't any constant symbol, because otherwise the so-called Herpon universe would be empty. So that finitely many of those, if you form a disjunction here, make this actually a topology. And let's try C. Well, you get this, this is not a tautology, very big. So let's try G of C, you get this. This is not a tautology, very bad. But if you take the disjunction of these two things by the overlap here, you get a tautology. And so two terms suffice to make this exist statement a tautology. And so that's what Herpon says. Here, this is in full glory, the result, Herpon's theorem. But Herpon's theorem already doesn't hold in this form. If you add equality axioms, then you get what's called a quasi-tautology. And it doesn't hold for theories. However, it works in some sense nicely for theories where all the axioms are purely universal, like the equality axioms. Because you can just take all the universal axioms and pull them as an implicative assumption to your statement. And then this prenexes as just one bigger existential quantifier, and yet we do Herpon on that. So Herpon's theorem generalizes to open, so-called open theories, theories where you have, as is somewhere stated, maybe not. It generalizes to so-called open theories, with pure universal axioms, in the sense that you also get a finite disjunction. The disjunction will then build up out of the material, not just of AH, but also of the non-logical axioms in your theory. And instead of being a tautology, it will be just a statement provable in this theory. So that is very convincing, and it already has applications. So for example, Lukács used this in the mid-80s, to analyze the field modeling result of Roth on Diophantine approximation. So Roth had proven that in 55 that there are only finitely many exceptionally good rational approximations to an irrational number. And what Lukács obtained using that, basically this thing can be formalized in an open theory, and then by applying Herpon's actually extracting these Herpon terms, he got a polynomial, the first polynomial bound before there were exponential bounds on the number of solutions. It's still an open problem, and would probably maybe get a Fields medal if somebody could prove there is a computable bound on the height of the solution. It's a big open problem. If you have a finiteness statement, you in general have neither bounds on the height nor on the number. If you have on the height, then in particular on the number. But in general, you have neither. But there are cases where you have a bound on the number of solutions, but not on the height. I mean, you can make up such cases there. No. The question is whether this is one. So it could be that there is no computable bound on the height, or it just hasn't been. So this is an early success, by the way, independently then of Lukács, another Fields medalist, Bombieri, also got, and Mr. Davis van der Poel got a result of this form. But you know, being a non-expert, a logician, you could do just as well, and even, I know it was present as my supervisor, so he did it in 85 and gave lectures on this well before this paper appeared. Good. Here's another nice example due to Ulrich Berger. You have this Gödel phenomenon of incompleteness, which basically never happens in mathematics. Now, there is already on the finitary level a Gödel phenomenon, as Harvey Friedman likes to point out. If instead of saying something is unprovable, you say it is provable, but the proof doesn't fit into the universe, then you have already Gödel phenomena in pure logic. Because there are these things that you have proofs in pure logic that you can easily write down using cuts, but if you want to write them cut-free, or if you want to write the Herpon disjunction, then the shortest Herpon disjunction has size 2 to the 2 to the 2 to the 2 to the, and so on. So as far as feasibility is concerned, these are just as unprovable than being really unprovable. But again, it is very complicated. I like to teach Herpon's theorem, but it's very complicated, despite logic saying you have to expect on a daily basis 2 to the 2 to the 2 to the, it's very complicated to get any non-trivial Herpon disjunction. So the example I gave had length 2, and fortunately Ulrich Berger constructed one of length 3. I haven't seen any natural example of length 4. But this is length 3. So this is a nice recreational thing, because it operates in an open theory. So think of this as a fragment of number theory, where you just have a successor. But the only thing about the successor you use here is that it's never zero. And then you have a new function symbol, an extra function symbol, and in this open theory you can prove that there is a non-fixed point of this thing here. So there is an x such that f applied to the successor of f of x is different from x. And one can see this by applying general nonsense. You assume that f is, you first conclude, so you assume that the opposite would be true, then you conclude from this that it's injective, because if it would not be injective, then two numbers would be put together here, but then you cannot recover them as distinct later. So the thing has to be injective. On the other hand, it cannot be injective because it's already injective on, because it's already surjective on all successor numbers. If you just apply f to a number which starts with a successor symbol, so which is a successor number, you get all numbers. So you're surjective already on the positive numbers. So how can you be injective? Because a poor zero also has to receive a value. So you have a contradiction, thereby you have shown that this was false, so there's an x. And it is very nice to use Herpon's theorem now to extract terms. Terms, first of all, witnessing this existential quantifier, but as I said, you pull this as an implicative assumption, so you can also search for what instances of this axiom you have used. So you have never used that it was a real successor, you just used that it's at one point different from zero, as we did. Well, actually, I guess there are exercise sessions, so that's something where I didn't give a solution. So you can try to, it's a recreation of mathematics. You need three terms here and one term there. The first two terms are zero and f of zero, but the third term is not f of zero. That's the nice thing here. Maybe some surprising third term. Yes, modern technology can be featured to contemplate about this. Good. Now, Herpon's theorem is nice because, as we discussed, but it has this extreme complexity in general, and moreover, it doesn't respect the internal structure of a proof, because basically, if you have a Herpon proof, you have a cut-free proof. You start everything from a tautology and just introduce quantifiers. And so the interpretation is non-modular. So you cannot just say, I have a lemma A, and then prove B from A implies B, and then proving A, and then getting B. You first do the Herpon bounds junction for A, then do the Helmholtz junction for A and plus B, and compute one for B. This doesn't work. You will see it fails in a particular grim way. Now, the other limitation is that it doesn't even work for number theory. It only works if you have an open theory. So that's good enough for quantifier free induction. But if you have already induction with one quantifier, Helmholtz theory is false for this. Now let's see how we could generalize it. So you could take this example again, and rather than writing a disjunction, you could say you solve this Helmholtz normal form by actually making, you know, you recall the Helmholtz terms with C and G of C. You can just say I write this as a functional, which is defined by a case distinction. And now one realizes that what's special about logic is that only finite case distinction functionals are sufficient. But of course you cannot expect that this will be always sufficient, but allowing for five more general classes of operators and functionals, you might be able to treat, for example, number theory. And that's the basis of Kreisel's so-called no-counter example interpretation. So the no-counter example interpretation asks for solving the Helmholtz normal form, which we now write here in second order style. For every x, for every g, there is a y, and finding a y depending in x and g. And why is this called no counter? Because this function g, recall how we proved that ah was equivalent to ax. So suppose a is false, then there is a strategy g to falsify it. So g is an attempt to falsify the statement, and phi says, give me your strategy, I will show how wrong you are. So I refute your attempted refutation of the principle. So that's why it's called the no counterexample interpretation. And now we can do, I just explained it in a simple case, but it's already very interesting. This statement needs actually induction for one quantifier formulas, so it's precisely at the borderline, it's above what Helmholtz can treat. It's a statement, again, you recall from your first weeks in study, that every bounded sequence which is monotone is Cauchy. So here's just, for simplicity, it doesn't matter, unit interval, it's a secant unit interval, for simplicity, it doesn't matter that that be rational. For every bounded sequence, every monotone sequence, here non-increasing, say, of rational numbers in the unit interval is Cauchy. I wrote this here slightly redundant, but it's the same as the usual Cauchy property. And now the Helmholtz normal form writes like this. So it says, rather than asking for a Cauchy point, so that from this point on forever, the Cauchy property will hold, you just ask this to hold, to succeed against any attacker. So suppose somebody attacks your Cauchy property with a function g, then you show this attacker to be wrong by producing an n. So the attacker says, give me your n. I will show you if I jump from your n to g of n, I found a fluctuation where you claim there isn't one. And you refute this. Yeah? Now, why do you have to do this? Because this is a real-life non-computability, not like the Hodgkin problem, because Speckle showed there are very easy sequences which do not have a computable rate of convergence, so you cannot solve this directly. And if you look into numerical mathematics optimization, in the end of the day, many convergence algorithms used actually depend on that some norm is decreasing to somewhere, and therefore is bounded, it is convergent, and so this principle of monotone convergence is used very frequently to establish convergence of devices, and it's non-computational. However, if you write it in Kreisel style, there is a very simple solution, and it's again extremely uniform. The solution actually doesn't have anything to do with the sequence. It works for every sequence. The bound works for every sequence. So what you do is you just take your function g, you slightly change it, call this g tilde, and then you just keep iterating g tilde a number of times, starting from zero. And the number of times is very finite, given your epsilon. It's basically 1 divided by epsilon. And you find such a point. And Terence Tao called this a meter stable formulation, so he called this an interval of meter stability in this article which I had mentioned from 2008. Now, actually, what the proof shows is you don't have to go through all numbers up to this one. You just have to go to the jumps of G tilde. So 0, G tilde of 0, G tilde of G tilde of 0, and this 2 to the k many times. One of these terms has to be a witness for n. So you do actually have a Hermite disjunction for this statement. Well, do you? What is the difference between this thing and a proper Hermite disjunction? In a proper Hermite disjunction, the length was fixed in this exercise I gave to you. It was 3, I claim, irrespectively of what the parameters of the problem are, what the f and so on. Here, it is 2 to the k, and k features as a variable in the problem. So we cannot even write this down as in a normal logical setting. It will need infinitely formulas to write this down. So it's not a normal, but it's very close to being a Hermite disjunction. So it's a very natural way. Now, because it's so uniform, it doesn't depend on the sequence, you can actually rephrase things in a finitary way, similar to how Friedman talks about finitary versions. So this is a finitary version of the statement. You say, actually, the finite convergence principle, I mean, the convergence of monotone sequences can be written in a way so that you don't even talk about sequences, you just talk about finite vectors. Because you say, for every error, epsilon, given here by k, and for every counter function, there is an n so large that if you have a finite vector of elements of real numbers decreasing of this a vector of this size, then already on this vector you find this interval of meter stability. And so tau cross is a finite convergence principle, so we ask, is it always possible, or when is it possible to replace analytic principles by a finite principle, which in some sense is equivalent to the original principle and the causes. Now, here's a real application for this, and it was actually this context in which Tao discusses this, namely the mean ergodic theorem of von Neumann. So in the Hilbert space, and you have a linear self-mapping, which is Lipschitz 1, non-expansive, and then you consider the ergodic average of this mapping. And then the result states in the formulation of Weiss that this is strongly convergent, always. And one can show, like in the Specker case, it's just more complicated here than actually Arvi Tausner used an example, used a trick of Bishop, which was mentioned this morning, to show that there cannot be a computable rate of convergence, but there is a primitive recursive rate of meter stability they show. I investigated a more general case of this. Gerrit Birkhoff in 1939 had proven this even to hold in uniformly convex Balmer spaces for any LP space for p greater than 1, not just L2, for instance. And that proof is actually easier to analyze and together with Loystian. But I have to say, this paper was done in 2007, so our paper came later. But it's a much more general and much better bound. And so I produce this bound here. So you get a bound on the meter stability, and again it's extremely uniform. Basically it depends only on the error, the counter function g, the initial norm bound on your starting point of your ergodic situation, and a measure of how uniformly convex your space is. It's called a modulus of uniform convexity. And here it is, it's almost similar like this toy example. Just the proof is much more complicated, but it's the same thing. You have a slightly massaged function, you slightly massage g into a function h tilde, which you iterate a couple of times. And that's what you do. Good. Here's some history. So when Tao used this meter stability and asked for explanation, actually the first rates of meter stability not under this terminology have been obtained in these two papers. Tau didn't produce a concrete bound. This was done by Abigat Gennady and Tausner. We generalized it, and since then there have been about 50 or whatever papers on this subject. So here is a citation from Tau. So why was Tau interested in understanding these finite principles? Because in his famous paper with Ben Green, for which he mainly got a Fields Medal, where he proved that among the prime numbers there are arithmetic progressions of arbitrary finite length, he used finitary versions of very complicated ergodic theoretic and dynamical system theoretic arguments. And by going to the finite derivation, so technically speaking, to the now counterexample interpretation, and realizing that these interpretations allow for a uniform bound, certain arguments could be performed. And so he explains in a paper, we establish theorem, this is some generalization of the mean ergodic theorem to finite families of mappings, so that's what theorem 1.6 is. But what he says is, by finitary ergodic theory techniques reminiscent of those used in this famous paper by Green Tau, the main advantage of working in a finitary setting is that the underlying dynamical system becomes extremely explicit. In proof theory, this finitization is known as Gödel functional interpretation, which we'll talk about tomorrow as the proper way of setting up the Lacan-Lacan interpretation, which is also closely related to the Kreisel-Lacan-Lacan interpretation. So you see there is this nice connection that prompted by mathematical needs, Green and Tau arrived at certain reformulations of analytic arguments which are closely related to what a proof interpretation like a functional interpretation or a complex sample interpretation in a systematic way would do. And so there is clearly this clear evidence for the naturalness of such a proof theoretic approach. So let's see how we're doing with time. Here's just in general the null contact sample interpretation again, some general prefix. You do the Hermite normal form, you witness this. This is the null contact sample interpretation. So why not then just doing the null contact sample interpretation? Well, the null contact sample interpretation suffers from the same problem as Hermite's theorem, namely that it's not modular. You cannot really from the null-contact sample interpretation of A, and the null-contact of A implies B, get the one for B. The best strategy you can do is to forget everything you know about your interpretation for A, you go back to A. You forget everything about A implies B, you go back to the proof of A implies B, you start from scratch, and prove B, and start from scratch. You cannot do better than that. This is theorem I proved. And so the null-contact sample interpretation doesn't really treat the model components correctly. And here is, and the point is that it's too crude if you have more quantifiers than just for all exist for all, because then the X sum of choices which you use here are very non-effective because they are in front of an undecidable predicate in general. And this causes this connection between AH and A to become weaker and weaker, so that to solve an AH is just too weak in an induction hypothesis so that you could perform the modus ponens rule any longer. And here I give an extremely nice example where you see this problem. And interestingly, by the way, this problem with the monotone quotient sequence is the example treated in Kreisel's paper in 51 on the counter. And it's the same example independently treated by Tau. Very interesting, he came across the same example as in problem. And the next example is the second example treated in Tau. So Tau realized there are already problems when you treat another, even more embarrassingly trivial principle, namely the pigeonhole principle. Then there's even a problem with the finitization in the sense of meter stability doesn't work any longer, as Tau realized. And this is the infinitary pigeonhole principle. So the infinitary pigeonhole principle is the world's most basic form of Bolzano-Weierstrass. It says that whenever you have a sequence in the discrete space from 0 to n, 0, 1, 2, 3, n, then it has a limit point, which means there is an infinite color occurring infinitely often. And if you do this principle is strong because it's situated in between induction for two quantifiers and induction of one quantifier. So in particular, if you add to a weak system that you can only deal with polynomials, the infinite pigeonhole ring, you can prove the totality of every primitive recursive function. So of 2 to the 2 to the 2 to the this function is nothing for this principle. So the whole complexity explodes. But see what happens in the null-contact sample interpretation. If you do the null-counter, you do the Helmholtz monomial form, you replace this k here by a function depending on I, then it has a completely trivial solution. So the problem collapses. So all of it's like a balloon when you just stick the needle and the whole air disappears from the principle. So what you have treated here is actually not the original principle, because what should result here is the complexity of arbitrary primitive recursion. And here you just have maximum. So it's sublinear. Yeah, so you see already. How can this be that you can use IPP to prove a for all exist statement which requires a fast calling function? The implication is a trivial interpretation. IPP has a trivial interpretation, but the principle you prove requires a fast calling function. Well, because the modus ponens doesn't work. So it already shows at this very simple principle, which is exist for all exist. So that's the next interesting case to consider. We considered so far for all exist, this was easy. And then we considered for all exist, for all, where indeed the no-count example interpretation is the right thing to do. But already when you have exist for all exist, you have to do something more substantial. And again, Tao intuitively hinted at the correct thing, which will be the Gödel dialectic interpretation of this. And the point is you climb up one type higher. You know, when already when you go to the Hermite normal form, you form these functions G. The witnessing operator then is of type 2, it operates on G, and here you need type 3, naturally. You don't see it in Tao's solution because it's everything's continuous and you can encode by lower type things and so on, but the principle is there. Good. And so what we will do next time is to set up a proper modular interpretation. Modular means you interpret every formula irrespectively of its logical complexity by a new formula AI, so that you can carry out this interpretation nicely over the modus ponens, so the modus ponens respects this interpretation, so you can perform a proof by recursion on the original proof rather than eliminating cuts, so that when it comes to the conclusion carries the additional information you're interested in. And the way we will set this up is based on Gödel's fundamental dialectica paper. But this we start tomorrow. Also, I just wanted to flash this slide because that's Gödel's T again. As we, in order to do this in a modular way, we have to go through all finite types. It is unnatural to say, irrespectively of what the complexity is, if for all exists, for all statement is treated as type 2. But a statement with 1017 corner for alternation is also treated by type 2. As the complexity increases, we have to use higher and higher types. And what one has to do in order to treat number theory, first intuitionistic and then by negative translation classical, is to use the functionals, the primitive recursive functionals of finite type, Gödel's T, as introduced by Hilbert. And so we will take this as a point of departure. Tomorrow, and then we will design a proof interpretation based on this and see how this can work, at least in some simple examples. Thanks.
Yeah, thank you for the lecture. Any questions or comments?
Yeah. So you mentioned one example using R1.
Yeah.
Are there other examples?
Well, I think there are some. I mean, you will know much more about than me. I mean, in some sense, Gelsel's work on Hilbert 17's problem is, I mean, related to the epsilon substitution method, which is at least that's where he got the original inspiration from. Based on some sketches of Kreisel, which are not completely conclusive, and so on, somewhere here. And that is a kind of epsilon substitution. It was actually the epsilon substitution method was the first correct syntactic proof of Hermite's theorem, so it's related to this. And I think some things, and probably in algebra, you are doing, and also more related to Hermite's theorem, with the geometric theories and so on. The logic complexity is very low, it's not an issue of induction and so on. So I think they are more in spirit of Hermite's theorem than maybe what I will talk about. Other examples, yeah, this Littlewood thing, on Littlewood's theory, you know, Littlewood proved that there are infinitely many sign changes between the Euler pi function and the logarithmic integral of blah. And he asked whether there's a bound for the first such. So he used the Riemann hypothesis to prove it first, and then used the negation of Riemann hypothesis to give a different proof. And he asked, is there a way to prove, and Kreisel told him that by using Helmholtz theorem, it's clear to get a bound, and bounds were actually then produced by Skuse and other people. So I think this is more in the spirit of Helmholtz.
More? Yeah.
Mary, one remark. So I agree with everything you said about Hilbert. You also had this this quote from Thomas von Aquin about consistency proofs.
Yeah.
The thing is that the quote is that to one who has faith, no explanation is necessary, and to one without faith, no explanation is possible.
No explanation will be satisfactory, because whatever you present, you can then, being a skeptic, you can also be skeptic.
You can always be a skeptic.
That's right.
But I want to make an epistemological point. So what you do by Altman analysis, for instance, is that you reduce a world where you have these kind of abstract objects. Let's take a concrete example, maybe pi on one comprehension.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So you have these kind of dubious objects that you might say that this is kind of a blatant circularity in the sense of Russell. And I do not believe in these sets. Mm-hmm. These infinite sets, they are obtained in a certain fishy way. Okay.
Yeah, yeah.
And then you can do Ordinal analysis of this, and then as far as pi 0 2 consequences go, you actually can prove it in a system where you only talk about numbers.
Mm-hmm.
So you have a certain ontological reduction. You don't only talk about these kind of dubious infinite sets.
Mm-hmm.
So you only talk about numbers.
Yeah.
But then you need to allow a certain principle that a computable relation, that a certain computable relation has now computable infinitely descending sequences.
Yeah.
By computable,
yeah.
I just mean
algorithmic functions.
This is epistemological.
Yeah.
This is an achievement.
Yeah, no, you're right.
And this is this one who has stressed this many times is Tacuti. I mean,
yes.
Some people have called it Tacuti's finitism or something,
yes,
like that. So there is a difference.
Yeah, no, there, I mean, there is definitely, it's just complicated to, you need some logical knowledge to communicate this to a mainstream mathematician. There is definitely, I mean, for example, already in Gensen and also in Euler's, just a consistency proof of PA. What basically is happening is one eliminates quantifiers, because in Gensen, of course, it's nonsense when people say he proved the consistency of ordinary induction by using transfinite induction. He proved the consistency of induction for arbitrarily complicated predicates by using transfinite induction along one quantifier free primitive recursive predicate, and same in Gödel. And I think, but then Kreisel would have said, aha, if that's, this is actually striking, so that quantifiers disappear along this interpretation. But if that's the interesting thing, then let's try what happens if you start with a statement which is not quantifier-free, like a consistency statement, or purely universal, but actually a statement that is existential, and see what happens to that. And then one is already, one has a shift of emphasis, because then you say, ah, what these techniques actually doing is producing a witness for this. And then it's somehow easier to sell to the mathematicians what you have done. Then,
of course, I totally agree with that.
Yeah.
Just to stress this,
it's
just a very simple thing. So, ontologically, you still have a reduction of a theory that talks about numbers to a theory talking about numbers.
Yeah.
So, you're talking about the same object.
Yeah, yeah,
so, that's why it doesn't look so striking as in the case of pi 1 1.
Yeah, oh, okay, I see. That's okay. No. But also, I mean, it's just much more simple than your case, but to say that ACA not is conservative or PA, it's also, I mean, a kind of valuable reduction.
Because you have a speed up also.
Yeah, you have a speed up. So I still like particularly this elimination of the Koenigsegg, because you don't have speed up, you don't you get any complexity. Yet the principle is proves very strong things like Hamdanov theorem, at least for separable spaces, which is what most people mainly care about. And it has this complete ability to have no impact on computational content. So so I think, yeah, all these things are extremely valuable, but I think in the, at least in the original writings, maybe, of the Hilbert school, Gensen and so on, the things were not optimally presented as mathematical results. So for example, they could have easily proven the independence of the Putschin sequence, yeah. So if they would have done this as a corollary, then this would have been, of course, much more. Or is Harvey Friedman, was Harvey Friedman who found that this ordinal analysis of AT or not or whatever could be used to show that the Kruskal theorem is very strong. So I think these are all things in line with Faisal's suggestion. Try to look to at least state some corollary which could be appreciated, even if you are not epistemologically interested, which some mathematicians, just as a fact of life, are not.
I think that's a good concluding remark. Let's have a coffee break.